Aloha, welcome to Sustainable Hawaii. We air every Tuesday from 12 to 12:30 at thinktechhawaii.com. As I discussed and demonstrated in last week's show, anticipated sea level rise to climate change is already occurring. Hawaii already experienced a record number of high sea level days this year, some of which I showed last week in my slides of the monster waves and resulting North Shore erosion this winter, as we all know from the epic Ediakau surfing competition that was held in February. Scientists generally predict the average sea level will rise up to 1 meter during the next 100 years. Hawaii and other Central Pacific Islands are expected to experience significantly greater than average sea level rise. The Hawaii Interagency Climate Adaptation Committee, ICAC, handbook reminds us the consequences of sea level rise for Hawaii are severe compared to many other coastal states, as the majority of our population and public infrastructure exist on low-lying coastal plains, which are highly susceptible to coastal hazards. On this show on May 17th, we discussed city and county planning responses to climate change with George Atta, director of the Honolulu City and County Department of Planning and Permitting. I've invited George back again today to tell us about specific city and county initiatives designed to either mitigate against or adapt to climate change. Welcome back, George.
Thank you for having me.
Again, you've run over from a cabinet meeting.
Yes, I have.
We always appreciate the time you give us. You're extremely informative for the public.
Okay.
So tell us about some of those city and county projects that are either mitigating against or adapting to climate change.
Well, I guess there's actually many kinds of projects, and these initiatives overlap. But as you know, the Honolulu was recently selected as one of the 100 resilient cities from the Rockefeller Foundation. So we'll be getting several million dollars, and so we'll be actually getting a sustainability officer. And this is also a charter amendment to create an office of sustainability. So that's something that is happening.
Is that going to be at the state or city and county level?
This is we, the city and county. Yeah. So Honolulu was selected as a 100 resilient cities, and this is across the globe. So it's not just a U.S. initiative by the Rockefeller Center.
That's terrific.
Yeah.
And I know that the state is also looking at hiring a sustainability coordinator.
Yeah, well, they used to have one, and I guess the position was defunded and the person who was there left. And so my understanding is they're looking to refill that position.
Terrific. And so those two positions will be working together.
Hopefully they will be. And for us, I think at the city's sustainability person is actually, going to be working on a multi-departmental basis. So somebody said that person should be in my department, but I actually deferred and said I think the person should be in the managing director's department, because that function of sustainability is broad and crosses all departments. So that person would have a better communication coming out of the managing director's office rather than my department. So I think that's the direction the city's moving in.
And they'll certainly be working very close with you in both planning and project implementation.
Well, they will be, and especially since they will also tie in with our transit-oriented development program, which is also a sustainability measure. And so, that definitely we have a lot of catalytic projects related to TOD, which the sustainability officer will be helping to coordinate. There's even talk about maybe moving my TOD division into this, either this agency or possibly a land assets management agency that is also part of the charter amendment. So the charter had a number of provisions which we supported, and these are sustainability aspects to many of these proposals.
And that amendment is going to be on the ballot this election, this fall?
Yeah, it will be on the ballot, yeah.
It's very exciting. So it also means that the rail approach is going to have a very specific sustainability component?
I think it has many sustainability components. I know this is not an aspect that's often discussed, because it's usually cost and whether it really have an impact on travel seems to be the dominant issues. But in fact, rail is a game changer in the sense of how we grow as an urban community and cluster around the stations. That's one aspect that helps us stay more sustainable, because we keep more of our open space by clustering it. The other thing is that the rail shifts the fuel use for transportation from petroleum products to electricity. Now, while the Kahe plant uses petroleum products, in fact, the electricity can be generated from many sources, and so there's been talk about possibly developing a PV field to help support the electrical needs of the rail. So because rail runs on electricity and not on petroleum, and there are many sources of a thing, whether it's wind or PV, that we have a chance of shifting the energy use for transportation away from cars onto a system that doesn't have to use petroleum products.
Now that power plant could, I would assume, would be developed by the utility, or are there other options?
It will probably be by a utility or a contractor. The way I guess the PV industry is growing is that HECO does not create the PV fields. Usually there are some other developers that come in, like Sun Edison or a number of these alternative energy companies. They develop the project and they enter into a power purchase agreement with HECO and then feed into HECO's grid. So, yeah, probably HECO won't do it. The city won't be the one actually developing. But if the demand is there, the private companies will come in with their proposals and so.
Is this, though, within the parameters of the planning for the rail and the transit-oriented
development? It isn't specifically on the planning, but there has been discussions with HECO about the power needs of the rail and whether the HECO would have sufficient electricity. It's a question that has been raised from time to time. I think the answer right now is that HECO hasn't told us they don't have power, but there's been ideas floated around about developing a PV field out in Kunia to help power the grid. And we, since I sit on the board of HART too, so we would be open to any suggestions that would make sure that the power needs of the rail are met, and if it can be met by a renewable source or partly by a renewable source, we'd be more than happy to,
In the planning of the rail, have you also looked at developing some of this power at each station and maybe even storing power with, for example, electric vehicle plug-ins and things at each station?
There's been talk. We have not put it into the specs per se, but there's been talk about either at the time of construction or retrofitting afterward, either the rooftops of the station and more importantly, our rail operations center, which has large warehouses where the trains are serviced, where those things should have PV panels or not. And I would say right now, the ideas are being discussed. No decision has been made.
I would imagine some of that discussion is limited by the limited budget and the difficulties that
definitely those things, both the budget and the schedule affect whether we would go for it now or later, because if everybody's aware of the increase in costs and then as well as the delay in schedule, and so we're trying to meet that. And when you add more things to the equation, it always gets more complicated and often in a delay in time. So there's a balance as we're discussing this.
But in terms of long-term operation of the rail, it certainly would make sense to build that in now, because it would bring down the costs of operating. Mm-hmm.
Well, I can't speak for the board as a whole because we haven't taken a position, but I personally think so. Yeah. It's a valid discussion to be having. And
absolutely, and certainly the transit-oriented development would be both a mitigation against climate change, because you're backing off on the use of fuel,
right?
And you're limiting.
By clustering development near stations within a walkable radius, people can walk or bike to places, and it's not just to the station, because when you cluster development, we're talking about services, offices, doctors, jobs would cluster. So people could walk to their jobs or to the services they need or to the entertainment within a walking distance. So it would be just in that kind of a compact urban setting with all the different uses. There'd be less need for a car, and so And the more exciting is, I think people will want to walk in that kind of a neighborhood. Yeah.
But we usually look at it as making it a better quality of life. But it's really important to note that the more we leave the cars at home, the more we benefit the environment.
Right, man. Less CO2 in the atmosphere, and hopefully slowing down global warming. You know, so.
Less fuel imported, less ships having to fuel up.
Yeah, and so, you know, rail plays a part in that whole future vision or scenario that we are looking at, definitely.
One of the things I know that you've been doing immediately is the Complete Streets program. Mm-hmm. Tell us a little bit how you funded that, and you've brought some great slides about some of the projects.
Well, the Complete Streets program is, I think, what I would call a shift towards mixed uses, like... I think I talked in the past about our Euclidean zoning versus form-based zoning, but
can you explain that for our viewers?
Oh, okay. Euclidean zoning is when you do your zoning code is defined by the type of use. So it's like residential use, apartment use, commercial use. So you separate your lands by type of use, and so you don't mix uses, and so you have these discrete homogeneous zones of use.
Strip malls came from that.
Well, that I think I don't know if you can blame the zoning on that. Strip malls came, I think, just from the suburbanization of America after World War II, when the automobile came king, and then the Federal Highways Act came, and all of a sudden the highways were being built, and the strip malls took advantage of the highway.
Okay.
Yeah, but.
But often we have our stores all clustered along one corridor.
It's along a highway corridor. That's the thing that. The focus is the highway became the main transportation mode, and so the commercial focused along the highway corridor. So the strip malls, follow that. So now when we're saying that an alternate means of transportation is a rail, and the rail station becomes the point of contact with the transportation system, and that's why TOD is around the station, whereas on the highway you could have it anywhere along. The edge of the highway, right?
Right.
So it tended to spread out all along the highway.
It's a big paradigm shift, but it's not a new one in places like Europe, right? Mm-hmm. It's something that's been done before and done well.
Well, actually, I mean, it was done in Honolulu, because back in if you look at old pictures of Honolulu, we used to have a streetcar system, and then it faded away, and then, in the old days, there was horse and buggies and things, but early photos of Honolulu show not only the rail cars, but people crossing and people and cars mixing in the street.
Right.
The streets were not seen as for cars. It was just to travel along, and whether you had a carriage, an old car, or horses or people, the street was shared by everybody.
Right.
And so actually, the Complete Streets concept is really goes back to that old model that the street is for everybody and every mode of transportation, not just cars. So the exclusivity of the focusing on the cars is really a post-World War II phenomenon. Mm. And we're actually going back to an earlier model where the street, and when we say complete streets, we mean it's for everybody. It's pedestrians, bicyclists, cars too, and buses. So it's to design a street for all modes of transportation. So it's multimodal, as I was saying, it's about zoning. We're no longer going by discrete zone, we're mixing it. So the street belongs to the car, the bus, the bike, the pedestrian.
We're coming full circle with planning, urban planning and transportation, just like we are with the natural environment, with understanding that less is more, hands off, allow natural cycles to take
care. And I think the thing is, there's a recognition that things are not so simple or clear anymore. And so many things have a multifunctional aspect to them. And the same with the street. From a transportation standpoint, we're looking at it as a multimodal facility,
right?
Not just for cars. Now, from a function standpoint, we're also looking at it as multifunctional, because you realize that a street is not just about transportation, because the mayor likes to point out that our streets are the biggest open space we have in the city and owned by the city is our streets.
Wow, very important.
Yeah,
point.
And so what do you do with this open space? And so in Complete Streets.
Well, when we come back, we have to take a little break.
Mm-hmm.
We'll finish that discussion and we'll look at your slides of the projects you've done.
Okay.
We'll be right back with Sustainable Hawaii. For a very healthy summer, watch Viva Hawaii. We're giving you the best tips and with our best health coach here. So, Viva Health Coach.
Viva la comida saludable.
Hey, Stan the Energy Man here. I know you're bored this summer. You're just sitting at home, figuring out what to do, go to the beach. Spend some time with ThinkTech Hawaii. Spend the time thinking about how you can contribute to Hawaii and making it a better place to live. And start watching some of the programs on ThinkTech, including Stan the Energy Man, where you'll learn all about everything energy, especially hydrogen and transportation. So we'll see you every Friday at 12 o'clock noon. Stan the Energy Man here on ThinkTech Hawaii. Aloha.
Aloha. I'm Kaui Lucas, host of Hawaii is My Mainland every Friday here on ThinkTech Hawaii. I also have a blog of the same name at kauilucas.com where you can see all of my past shows. Join me this Friday and every Friday at 3 p.m. Aloha.
Hi, you're back with Sustainable Hawaii and we're having a great conversation with George Atta, City Planning Director, about complete streets. And you were about to tell us about a few projects you have planned, and we have some slides.
Yes, we do.
Mm-hmm. And the first one is the 10th Avenue.
Well, most of these projects are at very different stages of completion. So as what you're seeing, of course, at the 10th Avenue is just simple striping, you know, of a bike lane onto the roadway system. So.
And this is in Kaimuki.
This is in Kaimuki. Yeah. So. We have various projects. As I think some of you know, the mayor has an ambitious roadway repaving, resurfacing program. And as we're going through our roadway repaving program, where we have either the time or the room on the roadway, we're kind of rethinking some of the striping. The simple solution is just striping at bike lanes bulb outs and things like that.
And it's important to note that even roadway repaving is an important sustainability measure because it helps cars to save on their fuel if they're not having all kinds of obstacles and like keeping air in our tires.
Mm-hmm. Right. In fact, I mean, it's not just fuel. I mean, definitely fuel is part of it, but you know, on repairs as well. You know, the less time you.
So this slide that she. Yeah, that is up is about the King Street?
Yeah, this is the King Street right? So, yeah, this is the first protected bike lane project.
Let's look at the before. Mm-hmm. There we go.
Okay, this idea of the King Street is it's a protected bike lane as opposed to simply a bike lane.
Yeah, and now so the after.
And in Europe they have a lot of these, and I've seen in Seattle, Portland they've got more.
And this
and more.
Is working out pretty well, isn't it? People complaining about it?
Well, we had a lot of complaints in the beginning as people were trying to get used to, how to maneuver, making left turns and stuff like that. We're getting less so, and then also the use has been increasing. We actually have statistics. I don't have them at the top of my head, but I think even if you were to drive along, in the beginning, you rarely saw bikes in the lanes. Now I think you'll see see many of them going in, and it's a two-way. You don't notice this is a one-way. Well, we converted it to a two-way cycle track. So in the beginning, we had it just as one-way.
But and I noticed too that it's a behavior change.
It is a behavior,
right?
Yeah.
And even
myself, I have to watch because I'm not used to watching for bikes, but it's just something people have to learn and adjust to.
Right, and then you have a Kapalama Canal project.
This is part of our TOD planning. This is Kapalama Canal and the street that's next to it. I think this is Koho Street. So this is the before, and we had a homeless encampment. This was a cleanup after the homeless encampment. But that's a continuing problem. And so, the idea was to activate the street, and so that the plan, and this is in the, we're in a contracting phase with a consultant.
And let's see the after. Mm-hmm. This is the consultant's rendering?
This is a rendering about, just an idea. This is not a design plan, but the idea of another pedestrian bridge going over to the Honolulu Community College site, and then on the right side will be the Kamehameha School's properties.
That's a phenomenal transition, and it's beautiful, but the one question I have in terms of the natural environment is it looks like you've hardened the shoreline of the river or canal there.
Again, this is Kapalama Canal. Yeah, so it's what stream comes down from there? There's a.
I'm not sure what stream.
Yeah, it goes up to Kamehameha Schools.
Right. So the question I would have is on that you're filling in on the. Where otherwise you would have absorption when there's an overflow on the canal. Would that cause problems?
Again, as I said, that's not a design. That's just a concept, right? And the idea of the concept is to try to bring the water, make the water accessible to people.
Oh, it's beautiful.
So that's the whole idea. And so the issue you're bringing up about how landscaping versus hardscape, I think is something that hasn't been really. We haven't gone that much into design, so you know what you see is not quite what you're getting, but it's just ideas. And
well, and we have to remember there are a lot of permeable surfaces now that can be used.
And if you look at the paving, it sort of indicates that.
That's beautiful.
But there's been other ideas of possibly even moving the street completely from the buildings and rerouting the street. But it's the idea is to make the, to activate the stream and the edge of the stream, and we are actually going through a study of Kapalama Canal and dredging, idea of dredging and things like that. So that, that it's really a transformation of the area on the on both sides of the canal and to make it more place people want to hang out. Right now, it's, you notice pretty desolate in that mostly homeless people hang out there because there's nothing to bring. Regular people to the area.
Right, and hopefully all those homeless folks have a better place to stay now.
Well, you know, that's another issue.
That's a whole other issue for another show.
But I think it's also a sustainability issue in the sense that it's a social equity issue. And so, you know, we have to solve that as a, because I think it's about sustaining our society and community. It's not just an environmental issue. There is a social issue to sustainability, which I think the homelessness is
absolutely
a part of
it. And I'm so glad you point that up because social justice is a key tenet. We can't be sustainable unless everyone can meet their needs. So some of the city planning projects around that we're going to have to bring you back on for another show to discuss.
Maybe on that one, the housing coordinator or the housing administrator
will definitely be addressing that. And you have one more show on Waipahu Depot.
Now this is Waipahu Depot Road. I don't know if, how many people are aware of this one, but this is the road that leads down to the police training and facility and the refuse convenience station. And this is the current condition. And then
I don't know if we have a rendering of.
No, there should be one.
There it is.
And this is just an interim thing. And actually, there's this is just one segment of it, and it's not It's just a, it's like a phase one concept because there is plans to convert that whole stream channel. That's Kapakahi stream,
and turn
this whole thing into a really active community area.
Well, that's certainly a social justice issue. When we make assets, our natural assets like streams, rivers, and the coastline more accessible for everyone, and that's a problem in previous planning is that we also hardened those assets and made them inaccessible.
And definitely the city's moving in that direction. All of these kinds of things, some of it is in the early phase, but the idea of working with nature, I think this whole idea about green capitalism and green infrastructure is related to using nature for the functions that it already provides, rather than channelizing. You know, you let the stream do what it naturally does. So, we're changing our codes and regulations there because, just as the Army Corps of Engineers is changing its mindset from channelization to more natural, the complete streets is part of it. What I didn't mention is that when I was thinking earlier was that multifunctional. It's not just for transportation. We realized because you'll notice under the street is our storm drains and our sewer lines. So the storm drains really is part of the old way of looking at stormwater runoff is just channelize it and flush it down to the ocean.
Right
now, in some of our complete streets designs, we're looking at rather than creating storm drains, making bioswales adjacent to the stream to catch that runoff, which would do two things. It would handle the stormwater runoff issue. It will also percolate into the ground. And then the complete streets also encourages street trees and what's called the frontage zone or the planter zone on the street. And so, you know, it would encourage putting plants along the street, and that functions with the mitigating the heat island effect, because when you have tree canopies, they'll, yes, you know, it cools down the
area. Yeah. And in addition, it captures that water, as you mentioned, it allows it to soak into the ground.
Right.
So we'll also be protecting our reefs from right now the phenomenal runoff. Mm-hmm. Yesterday, driving down from Mililani to Waialua, it was unbelievable how far out the brown staining was, more than I've ever seen. So we know that all
this
that
is all
mud
the remnants
and debris
of Darby?
Of Darby, and we've also had some residual rains, and the coverage of, you know, basically suffocation of the reef as a result. So you'd be protecting the reefs with this. You mentioned two other things. One is building codes and the coding that the Army Corps of Engineers is doing. How are you changing the city's building codes and reviews of that will be subsequent for any new developments to make sure that we're mitigating or adapting to climate change?
Well, I don't know if I mentioned this the last time, but the city has a new plumbing code that allows gray water reuse.
Mm-hmm.
That's currently in draft phase and soon to go to council. And council actually submitted a draft bill to allow gray water reuse. So that's one code thing, clearly more environmentally friendly.
So that could happen this year.
that could happen this year.
That's terrific.
Yeah, and then as far as our site, what's called our Chapter 14, which is our public works standards, we have a new low impact development standards for surfaces by on commercial areas. So we're, you know, requiring more stormwater retention on site, and that's already a law,
regulation.
But it only right now it only applies to certain commercial areas. I've asked my staff to begin to expand it into residential apartment zones, so that more of our codes require a low impact development standard for the site developments.
Right, and so you're going to be upgrading codes as you go along.
Right.
And that's going to make a huge difference with private development.
Yes, because it will become at some point a mandate that, you know, when you can't any longer flush the water or flush the things down into a tube or into a channel, you have to deal with it then, right? And so the codes require some flexibility and how to do that.
And are we going to see those codes being rolled out this year, next year?
Should be this year, because actually my staff has already drafted and sent to the Corporation Council both the plumbing code and the electrical code, and both the housing code and the building code are scheduled.
Well, we look forward to seeing those and having you back to talk even more about projects. Mm-hmm. I know we've touched the surface. Thank you for coming. And this is Sustainable Hawaii. We'll see you next Tuesday at noon.